Hey everyone, happy Sunday morning. We're so excited. All the mothers that are watching, happy Mother's Day. Honey, did you want to say something?
Yes, I want to say happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers. Listen, we salute you today. We honor you. We just want to thank you for all of your service, all of your dedication, everything that you've poured out and given over the years being a mother. Listen, the Bible says her children arise and call her blessed. So today, we call you blessed to all the mothers. Happy Mother's Day from us to you.
Amen. So it's going to be a great Sunday. And again, honey, happy Mother's Day. I've already done it, but I'll do it live on broadcast. Also, my mom watching out there. She's in Florida right now helping out our sister. We want to say a great happy Mother's Day to you. Love you so much. And Mama Ann, your mom, we want to say happy, happy Mother's Day. We love you so much. Listen, today is going to be an awesome day. I'm telling you, God has a message in store for you. It's going to be awesome. And I'm really excited. We're about to go in a time of worship. And I want to encourage you, if you're watching, wherever you're watching from, like this broadcast, you can share it. And let's invite as many people as you possibly can on the comment. You can type in people's name and they'll come and be a part of this. And as we go into time of worship, don't just sit back and fall back to sleep or go to another broadcast. This is the time for you to begin to worship the King. Notice with the devil was the worship leader. He got kicked out of heaven and we replaced him. Praise God. There is power in worship. Yeah. So I want to encourage you. Come on, this morning, I want you to lift your hands, stand to your feet. Let's go into a time of worship. You can sing with us. We're going to be worshiping with you. Come on, let's go right into a time of worship. We'll be right back.
Speaking life into these bones by the blood Bring life, you bring peace. shepherd. He goes before me, defender behind me.
My beat, my beat, my beat.
Hallelujah. What an awesome time of worship again. Welcome back. And those that are just tuning in, come on. Happy, happy Mother's Day. Happy Big Sunday to you. Well, we're excited. We got a couple announcements before we go into the Word today. And my wife is preaching today, so guys, you better get ready. She's a firecracker, and she's been waiting. But we want to give a couple announcements. This Friday, we're going to be on. Friday night, you can join us. Also, you can go to our YouTube channel, check us out, Tony M. Carpenter, and our Facebook page and all the different Instagrams. You can be a part and check out, share the different things. And all those that are watching in the Baltimore, Maryland area, Pennsylvania, Virginia, come on, text us, join the movement. Also, we got some exciting news. The Daughter of Dominion book is out. For all the ladies out there, if you want to grab a book, grab a copy. It will bless your socks off. It'll empower you. And then also, we got two new releases this week coming out. The book, the first book that I ever wrote is The Great Physician. It's all about healing. So if you're sick in your body, if you know someone that's sick in the body, get that book and it'll bless you. It has all the healing scriptures from Genesis to Revelations in the back, and it goes on deep details. And then the second book is called The Supernatural. It's all about how to display the power of God and miracles and signs and wonders. So you can pick that up. But before we go into the main message today, I want to encourage you in your giving. The Bible says in Haggai chapter 1, if you have your Bible today, we can go there. That's in the Old Testament. The Bible says this. Haggai was a prophet, and the prophet of God says this. In Haggai chapter 1, verse 3, then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, It's time for you, O ye, to dwell in cedar houses, and the house of God lies at waste. Now therefore, says the Lord, consider your ways. Have you sown much and brought in little? You have eat and not had enough. You drank a little but not been filled. You are clothed but not warm. And you have earned wages but put them in the bags with holes in it. Thus saith the Lord, consider your ways. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house of God. And I will take pleasure and I will be glorified, says the Lord of hosts. Verse 9. And you looked for so much, and lo, it came little. And when you brought it home, and I did not blow upon it. Why, says the Lord of hosts? Because my house that is at waste are wasted, and that you run everywhere to the man's own house. Therefore, the heavens over you is stayed dewed, and the earth is stayed from her fruit. I will call a drought upon the mountains and upon the land. And then it says this, upon the new wine and upon the oil and upon the ground, and bring it forth upon men and upon cattle and upon all the labor of the hands. The Bible is clear in Haggai. Haggai is a clear verse about people who are rejecting the house of God and people that are not seeing that the house of God is actually very important. The Bible says where your treasure is, there's where your heart will be also. And the Bible is clear. Haggai is a prophet. And he is telling the people of God, he's saying, listen, your house is beautiful, your life looks great, but my house, God is saying, my church is falling apart, it's lying at ruins, and it's not making any impact. And he said this, he said, consider your ways. He said, look and examine yourself of what you're giving to the house of God. Now notice this, it says this, it says when, he says in verse 8, go up to the mountains and get wood and build my house, and I will take pleasure and be glorified, says the Lord of hosts. So I want to encourage you today with your tithes and offerings. Again, when you give today, you're giving to God. You're not giving to a man. You're not even giving to a ministry. You're giving directly to God. And God is clear at the judgment seat of Christ, when we leave this earth and we stand before God, we will give an account for all the treasure, the time, our talents, our tongue, all the different things. And the Bible's clear. Jesus said, do not store up for yourself treasures on the earth, but rather lay up yourself treasures on heaven. So you can be a blessing today. The Bible's clear in Malachi chapter 3. It says, you have robbed God. And they said, what if we rob God? How can you rob God? He says, you have robbed me from tithes and offerings. Those that are watching today, the tithe, according to Malachi chapter 3, is 10% of your income. And then the offering is above that. And again, those that are watching, you're from different churches, support your local church. If you're going to church, be committed. Be a giver. The Bible is clear. Jesus said, give and it will be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over. So we want to encourage you today. You can go to the River Church Baltimore and pay your tithes. If you're from this church, or if you're just watching online, you can give an offering to the Lord and it will be a sweet, aroma to him. And again, Haggai chapter 1 is talking about laying up wood, going and getting wood and building the house of God. We're excited to announce that very soon we'll be getting a building. You can be a part of that project. We're going to be doing crusades all over the place. Me and my wife, we want to start a whole massive food pantry to reach inside the inner city of Baltimore. And you can join the efforts and even see that move. And then also, we want to do a whole massive drug rehab. So you can be a part of that. All those that are watching, again, you can go to River Church Baltimore. And again, you can be a blessing today and sow and give and watch how God will give back. And then even eternity, you'll have a great reward. Listen, service is not over. It just begun. And we're about to go into an intro. And then my wife is coming back. So you guys better get ready, because God is going to speak to you in a mighty way. God bless you.
Hello and welcome back, River Church Baltimore. And again, happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers. What an amazing and beautiful day and beautiful time it is to be born again, to be a child of God, and to celebrate the goodness of God in the land of the living. I'm going to say a quick prayer of blessings over you, and we're going to get right into the Word of God. Let us go in prayer. Lord, I thank you right now, Father, for this beautiful day of May in 2020. Lord, we pray for every man, woman, boy, and girl watching. Lord, I pray the blessing of God upon them, Lord. Let hearts be open to receive all that heaven has. And Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. Have your way in this message. Have your way in the rest of this service. And Lord, let yokes be broken, and let not one person leave this broadcast the same way they came, in Jesus' name. And we give him all the glory. And if you believe that, come on and shout amen. Hallelujah. I've got a message for you today, this beautiful Sunday, Mother's Day, called Redeemed for a Purpose. And some of you are very familiar with this story that I'm going to share with you in the Bible, in the book of Ruth. Ruth is actually right after the book of Judges in the Old Testament. It's in the time of the judges for the children of Israel. Before they went into a time period of having a king, they had a judge that was established over them as their leader that they would go to on behalf of the people, and that would direct and lead and authority the children of Israel. And so right coming out of this period of the book of Judges, we have a family that's highlighted in the book of Ruth. Somebody say family. Yes, today is a day about family. So we're going to talk about this family here. So Naomi is who we're going to talk about first. She was the mother. Naomi was the wife. She was a mother. And she had a family of a husband and two sons. And there was a famine in Israel at the time. And the husband moved Naomi and their two sons to the land of Moab. The land of Moab. And there in the land of Moab, her two sons married two Moabite women named Ruth and Orpah. And what happened was Naomi experienced a great grief. She experienced a great loss. Her husband died there in Moab. Her husband died. He fell dead. He was gone. So she was a widow. And then what it couldn't be made any worse, her two sons fell and dropped dead in the field. So here's Naomi, a mother, who left her land, her hometown, to go to a foreign field due to a famine and bring her husband and bring her two sons. And they all went there, and her husband died. Both of her sons died. And here she is, this mother, left alone with her two daughter-in-laws, Ruth and Orpah. Ruth and Orpah, they stood alone, the only ones remaining alive. All the men had suddenly been taken. And imagine what Naomi was going through at this time, at this point in her life. She was experiencing a lot of suffering, a lot of bitterness, a lot of grief. But something God had in store for her, if she just continued to hold on. We're going to look and see what happened in this story. You might be at a point in your life right now where you're experiencing grief, loss, suffering. I'm telling you, there is hope in Jesus Christ. So let's go on and look at what happened in this story. So we're going to highlight Ruth right now. Naomi was the mother. Ruth was her daughter-in-law. Ruth was drawn to Naomi. Ruth was drawn to her mother-in-law. Ruth was a gift that God had ordained before the beginning of the world to be a part of Naomi's life. He had ordained Ruth to be a gift to her mother-in-law. She was not going to leave her side. She was with her. Her mother-in-law, there was something special about Naomi that Ruth didn't have in her own mother, because Naomi was a woman of God. Naomi was a woman that loved Jesus. She was out of the lineage of the children of Israel. She was a worshiper. and she put God first in everything. She was a woman that was a great influence in Ruth's life and a great mentor to her and a great teacher to her. So much to the point that when Naomi decided to go back to Bethlehem because she found out it was the time of barley and that the famine was over and that God was providing again for his people, Ruth said, "I'm not going to leave you. I'm going to be with you." And Naomi said, "No, you guys go back to Moab. You're young. Go back and get married again. I'm too old to bring you any more sons. Are you going to wait around for 20, 30, 40 years for me to have more sons for you? No, you're young. Go back to your hometown and live your life and remarry. I can't do anything for you." And Oprah, Lord have mercy, Orpah went back to her hometown, went back to her mother, went back to her people in Moab to live her life. But Ruth took a stand. Look at what Ruth said. Hallelujah. Look at what Ruth said. Ruth proclaimed, "For wherever you go, I will go. And where you live, I will live. Your people will be your people, and your God will be my God." So you can say Naomi had a great influence on Ruth with the love that she had for Jesus. With even though she was dealing with all of these circumstances around her of death, of loss, of tragedy, of grief, she was still standing strong in her faith as a woman of God, to the point where the anointing on her life drew with them, where even though Ruth could have had an opportunity to go back and to relive her life and to start all over again, she said, "No, I'm hooking up with you. I'm not leaving your side. Your people will be my people. Where you live, I will live. Where you die, I will die. I am not leaving your side." Ruth said, "Your God will be my God." And Ruth hooked up in divine covenant, come on, with an almighty God and said, "I'm going to be a part of the children of Israel. I'm going to be a part of the chosen ones. I'm going to be a part of a woman that's in covenant with the God of Naomi." So there was something very special about this relationship with Ruth and Naomi. And we look at what happened as a result of their relationship. So they get to Bethlehem, and it's the time of barley. The famine is over, and Ruth goes out to make sure that there's provision coming in for her mother-in-law. Her mother-in-law is resting in the home, and Ruth says, "Let me go out to the field to gather bread, to gather the wheat so that we can make bread and we can eat." And there was a field with a husbandman, the redeemer, the kinsman redeemer that we're going to talk about as Boaz. And Boaz was the next of kin to Naomi. And he happened to be the owner of this field. He was a very wealthy man. The Bible says he was a man of great authority, but he was also a man of a great heart. He left the scraps behind as the custom and tradition called for him to do for the poor that would come and collect the barley and collect the wheat to come and eat. And so Ruth went out to the field, and she's collecting the wheat. She's collecting the barley to take home to her mother-in-law, to provide, to be the one that says, "You know what? I'm going to make sure that my mother-in-law doesn't faint, that she doesn't die." You know, they walked on literally 70 plus miles to go from Moab to Bethlehem. They were drained. They were exhausted. Hey, they didn't have the vehicles that we had. They didn't take a jet. They didn't get in their Mercedes-Benz and drive from Moab to Bethlehem. Come on, somebody. They had to walk on foot, two women alone. Naomi walking on foot that far after losing her husband and her two sons, and Ruth linked arms with her and strengthened her and got her there. And now Ruth says, "I'm going to make sure that my mother-in-law is provided for." And she goes to this field, and Boaz sees her and says, "Who is that woman?" And they tell him, "That is Ruth, a widow, a Moabite, who's come here with her mother-in-law, Naomi." And sure enough, Boaz favors Ruth. He says, "Oh, wow, look at that woman." And you know, the story of Ruth and Boaz is one of the greatest love stories in the Bible. And everybody talks about, you know, "I can't wait to meet my Boaz. I'm going to get me my Boaz. I'm going to get my Boaz." But I always say, you know what? Boaz found Ruth when she was busy working. Ruth was not sitting in the house. Ruth was not waiting on a handout. Ruth was not sitting around grieving and groaning. She got to work. She was about her father's business. Ruth was busy working. So look at this, the kinsman redeemer Boaz. He was the next in kinsman in line after another man that was closer in kinsman to Naomi. And what happened was the other had to redeem the land that Naomi was selling of her deceased husband in order for Boaz to have Ruth. He had to go to this person first. And this one man agreed to buy the land, but then Boaz said he also would have to buy back Ruth to restore the name of the dead to his inheritance. And the next of kin said no. He said he would not do it. So Boaz rose up and declared in front of the elders of the land that he will buy Abimelech's land, and he will buy the land of the sons and that out of the hand of Naomi. And he also purchased Ruth to be his wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among the brethren and from the gate of his place. So he redeemed this family. To redeem means to buy back, to regain possession of something in exchange for a payment. So Boaz is a type and shadow of the kinsman redeemer. He redeemed that entire family from their approach of their widowhood, from the shame of their loss, from the famine, from the brokenness, from the poverty. The kinsman redeemer, type and shadow of the kinsman redeemer to come, Jesus Christ. We see that kinsman redeemer, type and shadow, in a man named Boaz. Hallelujah. But you know what? God is just so good, because the story didn't end there. Somebody say it didn't end there. Ruth and Boaz had a son. They had a son, and that son blessed Naomi. Look at what the women of the day said. They said, "Blessed be the Lord, which hath not left thee this day without a kinsman, that his name may be famous in Israel, and he shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life and a nourisher of thine old age. For thy daughter-in-law, which loveth thee, which is better to thee than seven sons, has borne him." So the family she thought she had seen perish had been restored to the genealogies of Israel. This baby's name was Obed. Obed was the father of Jesse. Jesse was the father of David. And David was an ancestor to Jesus Christ himself. So you can see that this child that was promised as the Messiah to all the world from the beginning of time, that Jesus would come and die for the sins of all humanity, was chosen to be born from a woman named Ruth in his entire lineage. So Ruth had this baby, and this baby had Jesse, that Jesse had David, and David all the way down, we see, was born King Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So look at this. The bread of life. The bread of life is what Jesus says that he is. You know, we went to Israel, and man, it was so beautiful in summer of 2017. And we actually were sitting on a field with our tourists, with our tour guide, and we're looking at a field, and we don't know where we're looking at. We're in Bethlehem, and he says, "This is the field where baby Jesus was born in Bethlehem. This is the field that the shepherds came to worship him." Come on, somebody. This is the field where the animals surrounded him, where the three kings came and brought gifts and laid them at his feet. And then he gave us his powerful revelation. He said, "This is the same field that Ruth was picking up barley on the field, where Boaz took note of her and said, 'Who is that woman?' And they told him who that woman was while Ruth was busy working, picking up barley. That place of provision, that place of bread, is the same place that the bread of life was born, that Jehovah Jireh was born. Jesus said, 'I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. He that believes on me shall never thirst.'" So God sent Boaz to deliver them from their shame and from their reproach. But God sent Jesus to deliver you and I from our sin, to redeem us. Come on, to redeem our life from sin and death, and to give us life everlasting. He redeemed us from our reproach. He redeemed us from our shame. He redeemed us from our guilt. And I'm here to tell you, you don't have to live a life of shame. You don't have to live a life of destruction. You don't have to live a life of guilt, because Jesus Christ, the Redeemer, the bread of life, Jehovah Jireh, he paid the ultimate sacrifice on the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago. And you don't have to go to a devil's hell. You can be redeemed today. Today, you can give your life to Jesus, and he will turn it all around. Hallelujah. So God was not finished with Ruth, and God is not finished with you, my brother, my sister. No matter what your situation looks like right now, I don't care where it is. You can be at the lowest of the low of the low of the low. God wants to turn it around. I'm here to tell you and to proclaim over your life that you're not going under, you're going over. God has a purpose, and he has a plan for your life. And I believe that specific plan and that specific call that God has for your life is going to come to pass when you hook up with the anointing and you decree and declare that that God up in heaven that sent his son Jesus to die for you is going to be your God. And that you will die for him because he died for you. That your life is going to be completely turned around. It's not about gaining this world. It's about losing yourself in this world to find him, to find hope, to find eternal life. I'm here to encourage you that God is on your side. Listen to me. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning, baby. Come on. Naomi was depressed. She was childless. She was a poor widow and past the childbearing age. It seemed as though all hope was gone, but a big God stepped on the scene, hallelujah, and sent a redeemer. Hallelujah. Psalm 103 verse 4 says, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. God will turn it around. He is a God of the turnaround. He's a Lord of your breakthrough, and he will break you through every barrier, every part of your past, every life that is filled with distress and distraught. Right now, I'm here to tell you that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords extends his hand and says, I love you. I'm here for you. I'm for you. My son, my daughter, don't turn around. I'm going to turn that thing around, and it's going to work out together for your good. If you believe that, give him a thank you, Jesus. Give him a hallelujah. Give him a yes, that's my Lord. Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you, you've been redeemed. You've been bought back. You've been delivered from sin and death. You've been set free by his mercy. And our souls have gained eternal life with Jesus Christ, that ultimate Savior, on the cross of Calvary. And you know, there's another example of a person that was redeemed. There's a gentleman by the name of Anderson. He went by Mike at 23 years old. Back in year 2000, he robbed a Burger King at gunpoint, and he's released on bail and sentenced to 13 years in prison. So what happened was his court documents and everything was misnoted, and he was never contacted. They told him they would contact him to come and serve his time. They never contacted him. So what did he do? He went on with his life. He started a business. He started to volunteer at his church. He got married. He had 3 children. And then the courts realized that there was a clerical error, and they contacted him years later. I'm talking 10, 15 years later to bring him to court, to have him go and face trial and perform and carry out his sentence. And you know what happened? He went there and he was released permanently of all of his charges because of the favor of God, because of redemption, because even though it said that he was guilty, even though that they had him on camera, even though he was guilty as charged, redemption came in place and said, I'm going to take those charges. I'm going to take them for you. I'm going to restore you. I'm going to deliver you, and I'm going to erase every charge against you. And you know, that's what the blood of Jesus did. That's what his blood did. Look at this. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7. It says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace. And it says in 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19, for you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. You know, the Bible says Christ has redeemed you from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, curses every man that hangs on the tree. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Psalm 119 says he provided redemption for his people. He ordained his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Come on, you got a story to tell. You got a story to tell. I'm here to tell you that God wrote your story and he's going to finish it. So if you are the redeemed of the Lord, say so. Say, I am the redeemed of the Lord. Come on and type that down there. Look at somebody in your living room. Shout out to somebody in the kitchen. Say, I am the redeemed of the Lord. Go ahead. Say it to your spouse. Say it to your children. Say it to your mama. Say it to your father. Say, I am the redeemed of the Lord. Give God some praise. Give God some praise for redeeming you. So I'm going to give you guys 3 reasons that God has redeemed you. There's 3 reasons that I want you to write down. I want you to get this in your spirit. 3 reasons that God has redeemed you. Number 1, you've been redeemed to restore your rightful position as a son or a daughter. I'm here to tell you, the Bible says, he who believes on me, he who calls upon my name shall be sons of God. If you believe in the name of Jesus, you believe that he is God's son. I'm here to tell you, you are a child of God. You are a son and you are a daughter. And so you have to get in position of victory. You have to know that you are not in defeat, but you are in a position of power. You are not a victim, but you are a victor. And you have eternal life in Christ Jesus. You don't have to live sick, busted, disgusted. You don't have to live in addiction. You don't have to live bound to sin, because as a son or a daughter, the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you and will quicken and make alive your mortal body. You know, look at this, that Naomi and Ruth, they were one day poor widow women. Ruth was even a foreigner. They were picking barley from a field of strangers. And literally days later, she was married and all of her land back, brought back from the person that owned the field that she was once picking. I'm here to tell you, Colossians 1, 13 and 14, get this in your spirit. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness. From the dominion of darkness, and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. I'm here to tell you that darkness once had dominion over you, but it no longer can. It no longer can hold you down. You no longer gonna have to live in that sin. You no longer have to live in that shame. You no longer have to live in that guilt. Because when you fall down, you're not going to stay down. The Bible says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from them all. That a righteous man may fall down seven times, but he gets back up again. So number one, you've been redeemed to restore your rightful position as a son or a daughter. Your rightful position as a son or a daughter means that you're to rule and reign on this earth as kings and priests. He said to men and he said to women, he said, fulfill the earth, subdue it, take dominion, have dominion over all of the fish of the sea and the birds of the air. You are made in my image. You are next in authority to God Almighty on the earth. So take your rightful position. You have been redeemed. You're no longer living at a pit of destruction. You're no longer living at a pit of fear. You're not willowing and wallowing and weeping and wailing. You are a child of God. You're a son or a daughter, and you have all heaven backing you up. You have the power of the Almighty God on the inside of you, and there is nothing that is impossible for you. Hallelujah. So number two, the second reason that God has redeemed you, you have been redeemed to restore your joy. God has redeemed you to restore your joy. Look at this. In one chapter, Naomi was known as the woman that tasted bitterness in chapter 2 in the book of Ruth. She was known as the woman that tasted bitterness. But now she was the woman who experienced the love as a tangible God that redeemed her life from destruction, that raised her out of the pit of death and of hell, and has restored to her the joy of her salvation. She got a bounce back testimony. Come on, I see you with a bounce back testimony. Say, I'm bouncing back, baby. I'm bouncing back. That even though I started one way, I am bouncing back. You know, look at Job, even in the book of Job, all the things that Job went through. He lost his children. He lost his land. He lost his livestock. He lost everything. He had bruises and boils and sores all over his body. But in Job chapter 19, what did Job declare? He said, I know that my Redeemer lives. Job chapter 19, verse 1, he said, I know that my Redeemer lives. And we see at the end of his life that Job received a double portion, twice as much as he had before. God blessed the latter ends of his life more than the beginning. I'm here to prophesy over you that your latter shall be greater. It doesn't matter what you went through in your past. I'm here to tell you that your past does not dictate your future. That God has greater things in store for you. That the blessing is greater than the curse. It does not matter how you started. You might not have been handed a silver spoon in life. Things might not have always been easy. You might have been an orphan. You might not even know who your mother is. You might not even know who your father is. They could have wrote you off. They could have said, we don't want anything to do with him. We don't want anything to do with her. It does not matter. What matters is what God says about you, that you are a child of God, that you are a son or a daughter of God, and he loves you. He loves you with an everlasting love, and he loves you so much. He said, I'm not going to leave you depressed. I'm not going to leave you distressed. I'm not going to leave you sad and grieving and weeping and crying. He said, I'm going to redeem you to restore your joy. Give him some praise. Give him some glory. He said, I will give you beauty for ashes. I will give you the oil of joy for mourning and the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. God is not dead. He's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Hallelujah. You know, somebody told me the other day, they said, You know, your husband might be the lion, but I see you as a lioness. I said, oh yes, the lioness. Come on, women. We're the lioness. I said, I take that. You know, the lioness is the one that goes and hunts food and brings it back to her family and brings that provision in. She goes out and she hunts and she kills that thing. And the lioness brings the food back home. I know there's some lioness right now that are watching that are making that yummy, delicious Mother's Day meal for their families. Man, that sounds amazing. Why don't you go ahead and comment, lioness, what you're cooking up today, and then private message me your address so we can come on by. We come with six deep. We come with six people deep, so let us know. We're coming by to get some of our food today. Hallelujah. Hey, I'm here to tell you that God will restore to you the years. He said, the years I will restore to you that the locust and the cankerworm have taken. He said, he will give it back to you. Let's look at Psalm 92. It says, the righteous shall flourish like a palm tree. Think about that, a beautiful palm tree. Man, those palm trees in Florida look so beautiful right now in this cold weather in Maryland. He said, you will flourish like a palm tree. Come on and just picture that beautiful palm tree sitting on the beach, sitting at the ocean, looking back at that beautiful palm tree just hanging over top of you with a coconut. Oh, yes, I see a coconut. Poke a hole in that thing. Take yourself a sip. I see that beautiful coconut hanging off the end of that palm tree. He said, the righteous will flourish like a palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall bring forth fruit in old age, and they will be fat and flourishing. Come on, fat and flourishing. When you're fat and flourishing, you're full of joy. You're not dry. You're not thinned out and shrinked up. You're fat and you're flourishing. Come on, you're filled with something, and that something is good. It's been good to you. God wants to make you fat this morning. He wants to make you flourish this morning with his joy. Come on, put a smile on your face and just begin to laugh, because God wants to fill you with his joy this morning. He wants to take those tears. He wants to take that sorrow, and he wants to give you the joy of the Lord this morning, which is indeed your strength. So number one that God wants to do with redeeming you, three reasons that God wants to redeem you. Number one, he wants to redeem you to restore your rightful position as a son or a daughter. Number two, you've been redeemed to restore your joy. And the third reason that God has redeemed you, you've been redeemed to restore your family and to change the course of your generation. Yes, I'm talking to you. Don't look behind you. Don't look in the kitchen at your son. Don't look over into the sunroom at your husband. Don't look over and say, where's my daughter? Don't look over there and say, Mom, I think she's talking to you. I'm talking to you. You might even be 16 years old right now. You might be 25. You might be 72 and say, you know what? I've missed the mark. There's no way that lady's talking to me. I'm here to tell you that you are a redeemed son or daughter of God, and God has redeemed you for a purpose. And that purpose I'm talking about right now is to restore your family and change the course of your generation. Your decision to live as a redeemed child of God will affect your children and your children's children. You are redeemed and delivered from sin and purchased as his own. When you hook up in unity, I'm talking mother and daughter. I'm talking father and son, husband and wife, sister and brother. You will invoke the blessing of God upon your life, because the Bible says where there's unity, there is the commanded blessing. Go ahead and decree and declare over your house right now that my house will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Go ahead and decree that not one person in my household will go to a devil's hell. That all of my children will serve the Lord all of their days and never stray. That my generation is blessed because I was born. My generation is blessed because I will fulfill my purpose as a son or a daughter, as a child of the Most High God. The Bible says, if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, I will be saved, me and my household. You'll find that in the book of Acts. God's promise to the Gentiles. You believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you and your household shall be saved. I'm here to tell you, your one decision to become a redeemed child of God will affect not only your children, your children's children, but the blessing goes down to 1,000 generations. Hallelujah. Ruth and Naomi's decision to serve God and to put him first and to allow the kinsman redeemer to come in and redeem them back made way for all of us to be here today and to stand here today and say, the Lord is good. He is our Redeemer. He lives, He lives, He lives. He's not dead. He's surely alive. Their decision to do what they did and to hook up in unity and come together to command the blessing on their family, that what the devil thought he took from their family, he can't have. I'm here to tell you, whatever the devil thinks that he took from your family, he can't have it. Listen, generational curses are overcome by the blood of Jesus, by His redemptive power, because the blessing is greater than the curse. The blessing cancels out the curse, and the blood of Jesus wipes away every generational curse. So don't speak those things over yourself. Don't claim, don't receive them, because they're not yours. I'm here to tell you that the blessing is greater than the curse. And the blessing goes down to 1,000 generations. And because you were born, because you are redeemed, because you are a blood-bought child of the Most High God, your entire generation is going to be saved. And if you believe that, shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm here to share with you God's promise for the redeemed, even in the perilous times that we're facing today. This word is speaking prophetically to those who will hear it. And I'm going to read this to you guys in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30 in the Message Bible, because this is so profound. I read this the other day and I said, this is profound. This is amazing. How timely for the time that we're living in this country, and the time that we're talking about the redeemed of the Lord today and what God can do to restore families. Listen to this in Deuteronomy chapter 30 in the Message Bible. It says, here's what will happen. While you're out among the nations where God has dispersed you, and the blessings and cursings come in just the way I've set them before you, and you and your children take them seriously and come back to God, your God, and obey Him with your whole heart and soul, according to everything that I command you today, God, your God, will restore everything you've lost. He'll have compassion on you. He'll come back and pick up the pieces from all the places where you were scattered. No matter how far away you end up, God, your God, will get you out of there and bring you back to the land your ancestors once possessed. It will be yours again. He will give you a good life and make you more numerous than your ancestors. God, your God, will cut away the thick calluses on your heart and your children's hearts, freeing you to love God, your God, while your whole heart and soul live, really live. God, your God, will put all these curses on your enemies who hated you and were out to get you. And you will make a new start. Hallelujah. Say, I will make a new start. Come on, God has given somebody a new start. God has given a family out there a new start even today. Listen obediently to God, keeping all His commandments that I'm commanding you today. God, your God, will outdo Himself in making things go well for you. You'll have babies, get cows, grow crops, and enjoy an all-around good life. Yes, God will start enjoying you again, making things go well for you, just as He enjoyed doing it for your ancestors. Hallelujah. But only if you listen obediently to God, your God, and keep His commandments and regulations written in the book of Revelation. Nothing half-hearted here. You must return to God, your God, totally, heart and soul, holding nothing back. This commandment that I'm commanding you today isn't too much for you. It's not out of your reach. It's not on a high mountain. You don't have to get mountaineers to climb the peak and bring it down to your level and explain it before you can have it. And it's not across the ocean. You don't have to send sailors out to get it, bring it back, and then explain it before you can live it. No, the word is right here and now, as near as the tongue in your mouth, as near as the heart in your chest. Just do it. Just do it. God is calling you today. He's calling people today. No matter where you're at in your house, I want you to gather as a family. I want you to call every single child out of that room. I want you to call anybody in your household, even if they're not a family. Maybe they're just a roommate. I want you to call everybody in your family and bring them over to your phone, to your tablet, to your computer, to your television today. And we're going to get real with God. I'm going to pray over families right now, and we're going to come together and we're going to decree and declare the blessing of God over our families, the blessing of God over our households, salvation and redemption, not just for you, but there's a household salvation. There's household redemption. Your children are going to serve Jesus, and we're going to decree and declare that together today. God is calling people today. He's bringing them back. He's restoring them to Himself. To be redeemed, you have to come to Jesus. You have to repent. You have to receive His forgiveness, and He will deliver you from death, hell, and the grave. So I want everybody that's watching under the sound of my voice, gather with your family, gather with your children, husband and wife, come together. And I want to ask you this question. Where would you go if you were to die today? What would happen to you if you laid your head on your pillow and tonight was your last night on this earth? I'm here to tell you there's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. You don't have to go to a devil's hell because 2,000 years ago, the price was paid and the blood was shed for you. You know, God says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man would hear me and would open the door and let me in, I will come in and I will sup with him and he with me. He said, come unto me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He said, take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. I might not be able to physically see you right now. I might not know everything that you've gone through, every circumstance, every trial that has come to your family. But I'm here to tell you that God loves you, that he's watching even right now where you are in your home from heaven. And he loves you. He loves you with an everlasting love. And I just see him wrapping his arms around families even right now. Maybe you're holding your phone alone and you say, you know what? I don't have a family. I'm all alone. I've lost everything, or I'm separated from my family right now. God loves you. And Jesus himself is wrapping his arms around you right now. And he's saying, son, daughter, please, I'm urging you. Open the door. Let me in. I want to redeem you. I want to redeem your life from destruction. I want to redeem you out of that pit. I want to be your hope. I want to give you a second chance. Allow him to make your ladder greater. Allow him to give you a double portion. Allow him to bless you for everything that you've been through. Allow him into your heart and say, Lord, I will accept you. I will allow you to come in. I will let you be my Lord and Savior. I will allow you to redeem me. And the redeemed of the Lord has a different life. The redeemed of the Lord is set apart. The redeemed of the Lord doesn't continue to live a life of sin. When you're redeemed, you're filled with the joy of the Lord. The grief, the sorrow, the contention, the strife, the disunity, that stuff is canceled out by the blood of Jesus. So every head bow, every eye close. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you're listening under the sound of my voice and you don't know where you would spend eternity, if anybody that's hearing this message right now, I'm here to tell you that Jesus Christ came and shed his blood and died for you and rose again so that you could have eternal life with him. I want you to say this prayer with me with your heart and lips out loud. Say, dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me and cleanse me. Set me free. I thank you, Lord, that you died for me, you rose from the dead, and you're coming back again for me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Lord, I give you my life. I thank you for redeeming me, and I'm never going back to the past. Lord, thank you for being my Savior in Jesus' mighty name. Hey, if you said that prayer, we want to know. Go ahead and comment there and say, I said that prayer. My son said that prayer. My daughter said that prayer. My husband said that prayer. Comment there so that we can reach out to you and make sure that you have the five keys that we want to give you that happen after salvation to ensure that you live a victorious life, to ensure that you're growing as a disciple and in the things of God. And as we close out today, I really feel to do this. I really want to pray over families. I want to pray over the mothers, but I also want to pray over the fathers. I want to pray over the children. I want to pray over every single person, because if you're listening and you might say, you know what? I'm not a mother or I'm not a father, but you know what? You're a son or you're a daughter to somebody because you were born from somebody. We all came from somewhere, right? And God knew your name before your parents even knew your name. He said he knew you and called you and ordained you before you were in your mother's womb. So I believe that everybody watching right now has a specific call and a specific purpose on their life. And I don't want anybody watching to stand before Jesus Christ that day and say, I wish that I had said that prayer. I wish that I had been in agreement. I wish that I had come together with my family and prayed this prayer so that we could decree and declare over this household that we're going to serve Jesus and that nobody in this household is going to a devil's hell. So I believe you said that prayer. And so right now, I want to link up with you in agreement for your family, for your household salvation. And mothers, there's mothers out there that have been believing God for years that their children come to know the Lord. So maybe you're watching this program and maybe you haven't been to church in years, but you know that your mother has been praying for you to go to church. Hey, make her Mother's Day today. Give her a call and say, I watched the broadcast that was preaching some good news about getting redeemed. And Mom, I said that prayer today. And the pastor's wife that was speaking, she said for me to call you and tell you that I said that prayer. Come on, somebody. That's the Mother's Day gift that she wants. She wants to know that her son, her daughter is serving Jesus, that they're not going by the wayside, but that they're serving Jesus. So as a family, I'm going to say a prayer over every single person watching. Lord, I thank you right now, Lord, for every family, every household that's watching. Lord, I decree and declare the blessing of God over that household. I cancel out every plan of the wicked. I thank you, Lord, that calamity will not have its way with them, that no weapon formed against them shall prosper. Lord, I thank you, Father, that you've given your angels charge over them to in all of their ways of obedience and service, that no plague can come nigh their dwelling. Lord, I thank you, Father, for the blessing of God that overrides the curse. We cancel the curse. We cancel it. We rule it out. We call it null and void by the blood of Jesus. We thank you that every son and daughter is made holy and righteous because of your blood. Lord, we decree and declare that not one person listening under the sound of my voice will go to a devil's hell. Lord, we thank you for a testimony of household salvations. Lord, we thank you for a testimony of unity and love in these families, Lord. I come against any division. I come against rebellion, which is as a sin of witchcraft. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord, for restoring the sons to their fathers, the daughters to their mothers. I thank you, Lord, that it is your will that not one should perish, but that all would have eternal life. And I thank you, Lord, for the goodness of God that leads man to repentance, for the love of Jesus that stays with them and stays in their hearts and never leaves them, never forsakes them. I thank you for the love of the Father to come and just engulf every person that has experienced loss, every person that may have even lost a mother in the last 12 months. I thank you, Lord, for the Father's love to encamp all around them and to fill them and to restore the joy of their salvation. I thank you so much for watching this broadcast today. Hey, we want to encourage you to share this if you have not shared it yet, to reach out to us if you said that prayer or you have a testimony in your family of what God's done in your family on this Mother's Day, this beautiful Sunday morning. And we also want to encourage you to check out Amazon and check out the new books and stay tuned for the post for The Great Physician and the Supernatural being released this week. And also we'll see you on Friday night at 6 o'clock for our weekly broadcast. Stay tuned for some videos and we'll see.
America, I'm in Baltimore, Maryland. We're excited. We're at the Camden Yards Stadium. That's right. We're at the Baltimore Orioles Stadium. So pumped, so excited. Listen, I believe that these stadiums were not meant to play baseball, but to beat the devil up over the head. Hallelujah. I believe one day this thing's going to be packed out. The Lord gave me a dream not that long ago, and I saw myself in the stadium, and I knew the Lord was saying, one day you'll be in the stadium preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I am so pumped. If you're in Pennsylvania, Maryland, D.C., Virginia, whatever you might be, connect to the vision. God is raising up a colorless army, and we're so pumped, so excited. We're about to do 5 weeks of revival back-to-back all over Maryland, Annapolis, Towson, all over Ellicott City, Reisterstown, Randallstown. It's going to be awesome. So why don't you be a part of that, and you can instant message me or my wife, and stay tuned. We got some more awesome, exciting news for you. Hey guys, it's Pastor Tony. So good to see you. God is doing some awesome things. Guess what? We're in Baltimore. That's right. The big B-more, the Charm City. Guys, we're so pumped and excited. God is on the move. God is doing massive, massive things. guys, it's Pastor Tony. We are live here in Baltimore. That's right, Baltimore, Maryland, Charm City. I'm so pumped. I'm so excited. It's so refreshing to be in the city where God has called. Listen, about 2 years ago, the Lord spoke to me in an audible voice. I was waking up one day in Tampa, Florida, at my house, and literally I heard God's voice, and he told me to go audibly. I heard it audibly, and I knew he was telling me to go into the city. And years later, I ended up here, and now I'm here. And just in January the 3rd, the Lord gave me a vision. And in the vision, I saw the skyline just like this behind me. And in the skyline, as I stood on the highway, I saw water going through my legs. And the Lord told me to start the river at Baltimore Church, to raise up a colorless army that would not bow their knee to the spirit of Jezebel, a fearless and a faceless. And that's what we're dealing with in the city, dealing with a lot of racism, a lot of crazy stuff. But guess what? Jesus is the answer. We saw it in Tampa under Dr. Ronnie's Howard Brown's ministry, how God used literally him and the staff and us to shake the whole city. The crime completely dropped. And that's what's going to happen here. So you stay tuned, guys. This is going to be off the hook, off the charts. We're about to do revivals back to back. We got literally 5 weeks of revivals. We're looking for venues right now. Listen, if you're anywhere in the Maryland area, D.C., even Virginia, you can come out and be a part of it. Connect with us. You can private message me. And listen, it's not about the efforts of one, but it's the efforts of all of us joining together and bringing this end time harvest. We're so excited. Thank you guys for watching tonight. You can check us out on our website, and we'll have the link below. You can click it. We love you guys so much. Have an awesome, awesome night. God bless you.
Around the world, let's go, 3, 2, 1.